In this short video, we're going to look at an evaluation essay on consent. Evaluation essays appear on exam 3, and you'll need to answer one essay on criminal, one on contract, and one on tort. The question is, the defence of consent struggles to balance the needs of the individual with the constraints necessary in a modern society. Discuss this view of the defence of consent. As usual, it's worth 25 marks and you would have 45 minutes to answer. This is another really interesting question, I think, because the law on consent is relevant to all of us because it's all about what we're legally entitled to consent to, what we can and can't do with our own bodies. And we should all, of course, be very interested in that. The image that I've chosen to include here is really what I think this essay is all about. It reflects the question here, which is talking about balance. So the law on consent is trying to balance two things, really. Individual freedom to choose what you want to have done to your body, be that a tattoo, a piercing, an operation, whether you want to take part in contact sports. The law has to recognise individual freedom to choose. However, that has to be balanced, on the other hand, with social paternalism. And paternalism really means, it's a bit like the word parent, that we have to be paternal, we have to look after society and protect vulnerable members of it, and we have to regulate what people can and can't consent to. So there really is a balance to be met, which we need to think about when we're answering this question. So if we scroll down to my suggested answer, as usual, my AO1 comments are in black font and my AO2 are in red font, and my cases I've highlighted for you. Remember that in an evaluation essay, you get 10 marks for your AO1, 15 marks for your AO2, so you want to make sure that you're not just describing the law on consent in all the cases, but you're actually discussing whether the law is appropriate or not, and linking back to the question about how these cases show a balance. Do the cases reflect individual freedom to choose, or does it show that the law is restricting choice on the grounds of paternalism? So if we look at my introduction then, I've linked straight back to the question, which is really good practice. So I've started by saying, the defence of consent struggles to balance the needs of the individual, this side, with the constraints necessary in a modern society. And it can be argued that while the law tries to uphold public policy and the needs of wider society, I do think that it has been too restrictive on an individual's choice to consent, particularly when we look at the case of Brown, for instance, a little bit later. So I'm going to go through the rules on consent, evaluating as I go. So first rule is that consent can always be a defence to assault and battery. Reason for that, bit of analysis here, AO2, is that if there's no injury, the courts will not interfere with a person's right to do what they want. But of course, if an injury is caused, consent won't be a defence unless it falls within an exception. And that's because of public policy, that we don't want people causing injury without good reason, if you like. So it's important to remember that consent is not strictly a defence. If the victim consents, then no offence has occurred in the first place because the force used is lawful. So the defence of consent really operates to defeat the actus reus of a crime, and it makes the action lawful. So a classic case, some quite interesting facts here in the case of Slingsby, but Slingsby is useful because it shows how the defence of consent works. So in Slingsby, I'm sure I don't need to remind you of the facts, students tend to remember these, but it was that case about vigorous sexual intercourse. And it actually resulted in the death of the victim. So a dramatic set of circumstances. But the defence of consent was valid even where there was a death here, because it's reflecting legal principle in that it was respecting an individual's right to choose what sexual activity that they engage in. There was no battery in that particular case, so it couldn't be unlawful act manslaughter. There was no battery because the consent to the activity made the touching lawful. So this case is quite difficult to reconcile with Brown, which we'll come back to later, but it's certainly useful fairly early on in your essay because it illustrates how the defence of consent turns what would otherwise be a battery into a lawful act. Remember that consent may be expressed or implied, so sometimes you'll have the person saying, yes, I consent to that. Otherwise, it's implied by conduct. So if you're going into a very busy place, you are impliedly consenting to a little bit of jostling of everyday life. And that phrasing comes from the case of Wilson and Pringle. It's also important for consent that consent must be real. Submitting to something because you're bullied or you're forced or you're terrified into it is not real consent. Consent must be freely, genuinely given. Fairly dramatic case on this issue as well, Oleg Bozhe. The victim, unfortunately, had been raped by the defendant's friend. She'd also witnessed a rape of her friend by the same man. Obviously a terrifying situation for all involved. When the defendant tried to have sexual intercourse with the victim, she submitted. So he tried to argue when he's being prosecuted for rape, well, she consented because she didn't scream no. And that's a really unpleasant argument he's raised there. And quite happily here, the Court of Appeal made a good decision and pointed out that there's a real difference between real consent and submission. And that's going to be an issue for the jury to decide. If you're going along with something because you're terrified, that doesn't mean that you've consented. So Oleg Bozhe, good decision, fair decision, telling us that a victim can't be forced into consenting. Of course, there might be problems with the jury deciding whether the consent is real or not. Different juries might interpret or misinterpret the conduct of the victim, perhaps. Victim can't be tricked into consenting either. So you've got the unusual case of Tabassum there, where the defendant misled patients in a hospital to believe that he was a doctor carrying out a survey when, of course, he wasn't. So they weren't consenting to what was actually going on here. Again, another very good decision supporting public policy that individuals shouldn't be misled. And it's fair, of course, that consent can't be gained by deceiving a victim. That's a very important rule in modern society. So far, the rules we're seeing here look fair enough. Fair enough that you consent to sexual activity if you want to. Fair enough that there's implied consent, that consent is real, that you shouldn't be tricked. And it must also be fully informed as well. There have been problems in this area where we've got issues about GBH. I'm just putting that in red because that's clearly an AO2 comment there. So there have been complications here. Deka, Clarence, were issues about whether victims consented when the defendant has HIV. In the cases here we're looking at, the victims didn't know that the defendant was HIV positive. If they'd have known, they wouldn't have consented. This was confirmed in the case of Kanzani. It's not limited to HIV. It's also been applied more recently. You'll probably remember the case of Golding, 2014. So what I've put there in terms of evaluation is that this part of the defence of consent shows that it's balancing individuals' rights and society's needs. If a victim consents to having sexual intercourse with a victim fully aware of their disease, then consent's going to be valid and that fulfills the needs of the individual, their choice and free will, also balances constraints in a modern society. But quite interesting there in terms of recent biological disease cases. AG's reference, the court imposed restraints on what individuals could consent to. So here two men chose, they consented if you like, to settle an argument with a fight in the street. But the Court of Appeal said that they weren't able to do that because it was not in the public interest. So their right to choose was constrained by the need to stop fighting in a civilised society. You could argue, is that really fair? I could have perhaps put that there in red, that we weren't allowing that situation, settling a fight, but we do allow fighting in boxing when it's for entertainment. Seems a bit illogical, a bit unfair perhaps. We've then got the case of Brown, very famous House of Lords case, of course, involving a group of homosexual sadomasochists who had caused injuries which amounted to Section 47, Section 20 GBH. None of them required treatment, but the House of Lords said that they were not able to consent to this sexual intercourse and the vigorous acts that they were trying to consent to, because it wasn't in the public interest for people to injure each other in this way for sexual gratification. They said that consent will only be a defence if the injury is in the public interest. And they listed situations that would be in the public interest: properly conducted games and sports, boxing. That links back to what I was saying there. You can't cause damage to each other for sexual gratification, but you can as long as we're entertained by it. I don't really agree with that. Hopefully you can tell that from my tone there. Reasonable surgical interference, tattooing, body piercing, horseplay, they're all seen as being okay, but not for sexual gratification. My evaluation that I'm bringing in here is that the list of acceptable categories illustrates the problems and issues with the defence of consent. Linking back to the question, consent is struggling to keep a balance between the needs of the individual and the constraints we need in society. As I've said, seems false to say that injuries caused during consensual sex are unacceptable, but they are acceptable during a boxing match, or such as in horseplay in the case of Aaron Jones. Clearly the law taking a dim view of injuries inflicted solely for sexual gratification. Another interesting point arising from Brown is that tattooing was listed as being acceptable. So in Wilson, when a husband tattooed or branded his wife's backside, if you like, consent was seen as valid. That seems incredibly unfair when you compare it to the case of Brown, because you could argue the injuries in Brown, similar to having a piercing, which is an acceptable exception. Lots of people over the years have commented that the case of Brown was a homophobic decision, where of course it was a heterosexual couple in Wilson. People have saying that the judges are imposing their own moral values, and that the law's struggling to cope with the needs of a modern society there. You can bring in consent and euthanasia, that no one is allowed to consent to the ending of their own life. But of course, you could argue that perhaps that's not right. The illegality of euthanasia has been challenged in a number of cases. Many people, including Diane Pretty, famously challenging the law there. So in terms of a conclusion, I'm concluding by saying that the defence of consent does struggle to balance the needs of the individual with constraints necessary in a modern society. It's very difficult, in all fairness, to balance what an individual wants to do with the need to have some controls on that. There certainly seems to be some contradictions in the cases. Seems illogical that you can't consent for harm for some areas, but you can for entertainment. Some cases are inconsistent, Brown and Wilson. So there certainly seems to be an imbalance there. Some recommendations made by the Law Commission, and these need to be implemented to make the law fairer.